Jackie McLean. A brilliant career in music that spans more than three decades. His artistry has constantly evolved, which is in keeping with the basic nature of the art form, which has branched out into many different modes while retaining its origins.
The common root, of course, comes out of Africa. That's the pulse, the African pulse. It's all the way back from what they first recognized as the old slave chants and up through the blues, the jazz, and up through the rock and the avant-garde, and it's all got the African pulse.
This, America's most significant cultural product, has been exploited, as have the musicians who created it.
Bought my wife a bottle of Coca-Cola so you could play on her.
Exploitation wasn't limited to the recording industry. Take the Flicks. A young artist who became a world legend had his art associated with cartoons.
Moreover, the originators have seldom had the chance to tell the story themselves.
You know the story of Paul Revere? Oh, most everybody knows the story. But do you know the name of the horse that Paul Revere rode? Hardly anybody knows. Nobody knows it. You know why they don't know it? It's because the horse did not write the story.
This, then, is a rare opportunity to hear a major artist of African descent telling his own story and that of his music. Jackie McLean and I grew up together in Harlem. As kids, we never dreamt that he would become as important to music as he is, or that I would one day have my friend Jackie appear several times on Like It Is, including the very first edition back in 1968. Nor be fortunate enough to recently videotape Jackie as he retraced some of his steps in an extraordinary life. Place in June of 2004. After talking about it for years, we finally hooked up our schedule to make it happen.
Oh boy, here it is. This is my first memory of New York.
Where are we talking about?
YMCA, right here.
Yeah.
Is that the Y?
Yeah, that's the Y.
Yeah, oh God, it looks so small.
So are you beyond the Y?
Were
you?
Yeah, we live down further.
Okay.
Yeah, this is where Daddy Cobb lived.
Yeah, that's where I learned how to
swim.
Daddy
Cobb. Yeah, and I was over at this Y too.
That's the YW, Jackie.
Now it's the YW?
Well, yeah.
When I was a little boy, it wasn't. It was the first Y. It had two men's Ys here. The ladies' Y was on another street.
But where this playground is where
this is where Miss Strange, right here. About right here. This is where I used to live.
Okay.
About right here. And there was an apartment building here with a candy store downstairs named The Strains owned it, Mr. and Mrs. Strain. And I used to come down there to buy my Hootens and play up and down the street. But when this is where my mother first met Daddy Cobb, Norman Cobb, who became my godfather.
So at what age were you living here?
From the time I was about three or four until I moved to 111th Street. I lived in this block from the time I was about 7 years old till about nine, or 6 years old until I was about nine. Yeah, this is it. And my boundaries that my mother gave me used to be from playing from right here up to the alleyway there and around the corner to the corner of 110th and not across to the park.
Jackie, where were you born?
I was born
Flower Hospital over on Fifth Avenue.
No kidding.
And then at that time, my mother lived on 135th Street, you know.
Uh-huh.
And during these years, we never had an apartment. My mother used to room, you know.
Uh-huh.
I was born right in the Depression. And of course, my godfather, Daddy Cobbs, used to pick me up here for church on Sunday and for going to the Y and everything, because he was like a father to me during these years.
All right, well, let's go into the next location in your life, the next stop.
Okay. Great.
Jackie McLean found fame, if not fortune, playing a form of music that musicians refer to as modern music rather than jazz or bebop, as it is commercially known. Mind you, this music is most demanding.
I spent 40-some years trying to play this music. It's no joke. It's a very serious business. One time, a classical musician was saying, asked me, you know, he was very inspired. He was flabbergasted by my playing. He said, man, you play, I would say, do you ever play anything like serious music? I say, what, you think I'm kidding? There's nothing more serious than a serious jazz musician. This guy's got so many things that he's got to think of. He's got to think of the changes, the chord progression. You have to think of certain rhythms to get. You have to compose all the time you're playing. It is a highly complex music.
Charlie Parker was a master musician, one of the most competent of all time. Not only could he sight read music as easily as you and I can read words, but he could play anything that came to his mind. He had a phenomenal memory and a rich, deep sound in his tone. He could play alto, tenor, clarinet, and piano. His facility was incredible. Some of the arpeggios and runs that he could play would literally take your breath away.
Jackie wanted us to see where another great innovator once lived, pianist Bud Powell, who, despite suffering severe trauma, reached out and embraced young Jackie.
What happened to Bud that affected him emotionally?
Well, the beating.
What beating?
He got beat up when he was with Cootie Williams' band. He was in Philadelphia. I guess he must have been about 18 or so. And Thelonious Monk had written music for Cootie's band, and he was with the band, traveling with the band. And for some reason, the detectives began to frisk and push Thelonious around at the end of the concert. And Bud ran to help Thelonious, who he loved from the bottom of his heart. And the cops beat him with one of those little billy jacks across his head. And his mother had to drive back to New York with him in the back seat, his head in her lap, traveling at 15 miles an hour, because every time they went any faster than that, he would yell.
Oh, man.
And so when they got him back, you know, it was just acting weird, so they took him to the hospital and they put him in for observation.
And so that's why he
ended up in the mental institution.
So part of him was still able to function as a musician.
But wait a minute, when he got in the mental institution, then they gave him shock therapy. And what they did to him was cruel, Gil. When they found out that he was just walking around in his pajamas and slippers and stuff, nobody paid him any attention. Then one day he slid out to the solarium and there was a piano there. And he opened that piano and sat down and started playing, and everybody came around and was looking with their mouths open. So then the doctors got a bright idea. I wonder what would happen if we gave him shock treatment in that side of the brain, the creative side, or whatever they do. And they did that to him and didn't send him back to the piano to try and play. They messed him up, man. But when
he
came home.
Was this at Camarillo?
No. Camarillo's where Bird went.
Yeah.
This was over there in the middle of the East River, Ward's Island. over there. And when Bud came home, he was still okay, but he had lost a lot. He used to ask me questions like, yeah, well, tell me about, who'd you say? I'd say Sonny Stitt. Who's he? You know, because those shock treatments make you forget.
Musically?
Musically, no, they never touched him with that.
Isn't that something?
In fact, he made all those records, like Un Poco Loco, all that stuff after, you know, those shock treatments.
You sort of adopted him, didn't you?
He adopted me. This is where it happened, man. This is like a shrine to me. I mean, this is where it happened for me, man. This is where I woke up and really tasted the music. My dad had a record shop on 141st Street and 8th Avenue. And one day, a guy came in there, and it was Richard Powell, Bud's little brother. He told me he was Bud's brother. I didn't believe him, so he told me he was coming get me on Sunday and prove it to me. So he brought me up here. I had my saxophone. And we went into this building and up to the second floor to this apartment. And he knocked, went in the door and sat me on the couch. And I was sitting there alone, and I had never seen Bud. I didn't know what he looked like, anything. Never seen a picture of him or nothing. I was only 15.
But you knew his music.
I knew his music. So he comes back and opens the door, and there's a guy standing with him. And the guy with him says, you don't believe I'm Bud Powell? And man, I almost lost it. I said, I don't, you know, he said, turned around and walked over to the piano and opened it and sat down. And the minute he hit those keys, man, I said, oh my God. Then he looked around and said, what do you got in that case? I said, a saxophone. He said, can you play it? I said, I know Buzzy, you know that song, Buzzy?
Yeah.
He said, take it out. And I took it out. He played an introduction and I played Buzzy with him. And he said, hey, you can play a little bit. How old are you? I said, I'm 15. He said, oh, wait, I want my wife to see you. And he went, brought his wife, Mae Francis. He said, look at him. He can play. Watch, you know. And then he took me in to meet his mother, you know. And that's how I met Bud. And he told me that I could come down anytime. And I mean, he took the ideas of Charlie Parker and reworked them. Even though he was playing in the same idiom, it was like a branch, another branch on a tree, one going this way and one going that way. And I was very fortunate that I was at the very beginning of my musical training, that I was able to sit. Not that Bud taught me lessons, he never did. He only sat and played the piano for me and taught me some of his melodies, but he never taught me theory or anything like that, chords, nothing. He just let me play by ear. And Bud Powell, I would say, is one of the main innovators of the modern music idiom.
Jackie was interested, however, in the saxophone, not the piano. And there, towering above him, was that colossus of a saxophonist, Charlie Parker, who Jackie worshipped and longed to meet.
It was the most important time in my musical development, more than anything. It was through Bud that I actually got a chance to really meet Bird. I used to run up on Bird on 52nd Street, me and Jelly, my friend Jelly. We used to run up and speak to him, but he didn't pay us too much attention going to Three Deuces, you know? And we would stand outside the club just to get a picture, just to get a vision of Max. And of course, Max was our favorite because of the way he dressed. And Bud, and Bird, you know, and Miles. And we didn't pay Miles too much attention in those days. But I didn't really know Bird until Bud introduced me to him in 1947, you know. I took him to the Royal Roost to a job, and he was a little jealous of my admiration of Bird, you know. And he said, yeah, he used to say, oh, there's Bird. I know you want to meet him. And I said, yeah, please, Bud, you know. He said, come on. He took me over there. And he said to Charlie Parker, he said, hey, how you doing? How's everything? He said, you see this guy here, this little boy? So Bird said, don't I know you from, aren't you the little one that used to come on 52nd Street? I said, yeah, me and my friend Jelly. And he said, Bud said, he plays the saxophone pretty good for his age. And Bird said, oh, really? So I remember Bird had a package of Sen-Sen. Remember those things you used to put on your tongue? And he went in his pocket and took some out and put on his tongue. And I said, what's that, Mr. Parker? So he said, Sen-Sen. I said, where do you get it? He said, in the drugstore. Then he had a pocket watch that went through his lapel down and hung in his shirt pocket up here, his jacket pocket. He looked at the time. Man, I saved my money. I went and bought, first I bought some Sensen that day, and then I saw those watches in the drugstore. I bought me one, you know. I mean, I was a real fan. You and I both, man, when other kids were running after Batman and Robin and those people, our heroes were Bud Powell and Dizzy and Charlie Parker, you know? So this is where it happened, man. This is like a shrine to me. I mean, this is where it happened for me, man. This is where I woke up and really tasted the music. And I used to run into Sonny Rollins coming down here, because Sonny used to walk from his house down here. And I remember one day I was walking up and I ran into Sonny. And Sonny said, "You coming from Bud's?" I said, "Yeah." He said, He said, "Who's the baddest, Bud or Bird?" And I said, "What do you mean, man? How do you mean that?" He said, "I asked you a question. Who's the baddest, Bud or Bird?" I said, "Bird." And he said, "Yeah, you sure of that? See you later." Split. And that's when a bulb went off in my head. I said, "But of course, man, it's Bud too. The two of them, you know? It's not just...
It's not either or."
Yeah, it's like spring or fall, you know? It's what it's like, you know?
So when did you start gigging?
Oh, I was already gigging as soon as I could play. Well, I was in Lou Wheeler's band. Remember, Lou Wheeler had a band with me and Jelly, and I forgot who the drummer was. But we had a band. We used to play up at Stitt for dances, and we used to play around.
Professional. How old were you?
I was 18 when Bud told Miles to listen to me, and I went down to Birdland and sat in with Miles's band.
At 18,
yeah. And we played Confirmation, and I was so nervous, Gil, that when I went out to the mic to play my solo, I was out there, and I went and played about 8 bars, and my stomach said, "Regularly." And I stopped, and my stomach said, "Roggy." And I ran from the stage, man, and opened the door to the backstage, and there was a bucket, a big garbage can there, and I just threw up in there. Now, meanwhile, the rhythm section is still going, and Oscar Goodstein, who was the owner, manager, he said, "Get back out there and finish that, you know?" And I grabbed, somebody threw a towel at me, and I wiped my mouth, and I went back through these doors and up the stairs, and Miles and Gene Ammons were standing like that, and the rhythm section was going. Seemed like it was an hour, but maybe it was just a couple of minutes or a minute. And I went back to the microphone and finished my solo. And boy, the audience thought that was spectacular, because they knew I went back there and barfed. Yeah. And they just thought, "Great, man, this kid did that." And so when I came back and stood next to Miles after his solo, he said, "I never saw anybody do that, man. You all right?" So I said, "Yeah. Yeah, okay." So after the set was over, he said, "You want to come to my house tomorrow?" And I said, "Yeah, man, you know." He gave me his address and phone number. And I went out to his house, you know.
What is meant by the woodshed?
The woodshed means that you lock up somewhere and practice on your instrument to develop whatever it is that you need, you know. And there's so much that you need when you're young. You need a proper sound, a tone. You need to be able to read music. And you need to understand the theory. And the saxophone or the trumpet or the piano, there's no easy instruments. They all require a lot of work. I mean, if you take people like Sonny Rollins, Sonny's a good example of a guy that goes to work every day from his house to his studio and practice, come home, eat lunch, watch television for an hour or so, back to the studio, practice, you know? And it was the same with John Coltrane. He practiced from morning till night.
And it was the same with Jackie McLean, because I saw it.
Well, I practiced a lot, too, during a period. Yeah, I practiced a great deal, yeah.
Jackie, a lot of your development took place when you were living in a different location. Why don't we go there and take a look at it?
Yeah, I'd love to.
On the left.
Yeah, right there. That's 961. When we moved from downtown, 1855 7th Avenue, we moved into this building, 961. And Gil lived right on the corner there in that brown brick building. He lived there on the second floor. And I used to look out my window over on that side, and Gil's house was right, his building was right there. And right there, in that, next to the hall there, was the kitchen where your mom used to sit, and the next two windows where your piano was. And your back would be to the window, I'd see you practicing. Yeah, and I'd see your dad coming home from work.
So Jackie, this is where a lot of
this is where my music started. Yeah, this is where my music really started. This is where I first got my alto saxophone for my 15th birthday in this building.
Uh-huh.
In my apartment.
And you were living there with your mom?
With my mom and my dad, Jimmy Briggs.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And
this is where you paid your dues.
Yeah, and that's where a lot of things happened to me from this building here.
What did your mother have to say about your success at such a young age?
Well, my mother wasn't interested in that. She wanted me to be a doctor, and she was brainwashing me about that since the time I was that big. You're going to be a doctor. Oh, you're going to be such a nice doctor. Coming up, that's all I heard. And then when I got interested in music, she reluctantly, you know, put up with it, you know. But then when I started going out and playing and everything, it just sort of just gradually became my life, you know. Gil and I played up and down these streets all the time. And I spent a lot of time in his house after school because we used to go in
back and forth.
Back and forth, yeah. And entertain each other, you know. I mean, I would make up stories, make him laugh, he'd make me laugh. It was quite a time.
But all of a sudden, Jackie stopped hanging out on the street. And he was upstairs listening to those records.
Right.
With your head in the closet in your room.
Yeah.
Playing
the saxophone.
Trying to learn those licks and those lines.
Trying to learn how to play the saxophone in the style of Charlie Parker and Lester Young, Dexter Gordon, and Bud Powell, Thelonious Monk, Dizzy. Those were my idols, and I spent a lot of time doing that because it was like I was waiting for that to happen to me. I wasn't conscious of it. But the first time I heard Charlie Parker, I knew I was going to be a musician. I knew it.
What impact did Bird have on you, Charlie Parker?
Incredible. The first time I saw him was at the McKinley Theater in the Bronx. I went up to see Dizzy's big band, mm-hmm. Jelly and I, our good friend Walter Brown, who is dead now. We went up to see the band, and I saw Bird in that reed section, and when he came out to play his solos, that really did it, because now I could see him. I had already heard his records, Now's the Time and Coco. And of course I heard Dizzy, Blue and Boogie. Mm-hmm. Those are the recordings that really pulled me into the music.
What was it about him? I mean, there were so many great artists at the time. What was it about his music that turned you on so?
The sound of the alto, it was like I said, Gilbert, it was like something I was waiting for. It was like he was a Pied Piper. And in talking to a lot of musicians across this country, many of them say the same thing, that there were little cults of people that, as soon as they heard Bird, they came together to listen to this music. Mm-hmm. And it happened in our neighborhood. We used to go, you know, Gil, when I turned you on to Bird, I think.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
and you heard him, and same thing, you heard Bud Powell.
Everybody got messed up.
Yeah.
I mean, it changed our lives.
It changed our lives.
What was he like when you met him?
Well, the first time I used to see him, I used to go down to 52nd Street just to watch him go in the club. I never could stay to hear him play because I had to be back uptown by 10:15 on a Friday night. So we'd jump on the train, and my mother didn't know this, of course, and ride all the way downtown and go across to 52nd Street and watch them go in the club. So Bird had seen me down there several times, and one night he asked me, he said, do you live around here? And I said, no, we live up 158th Street. So he said, well, what are you doing down here? So I said, well, we come down here to watch you go in. I said, I play saxophone, you know. So he said, and you can't stay to hear the music? So I said, we can't go in. So he let us come in, and we stood right by the door, and he went on stage with the band. They played Night in Tunisia.
No kidding.
And we listened to as much of it as we could, and then we broke out of there and ran for the subway. A lot of people think that the lifestyle of a musician is always a lot of slang, a lot of hip talking, and a lot of drinking, a lot of women. But I must say that the time that I spent around someone like Charlie Parker, he was more like a philosopher or a school teacher. He spoke very proper and talked about very interesting things, you know. I spent one day with him walking down 8th Avenue. He took me to see Hot Lips Page's body lay down on 145th Street. And I rode with him from Midtown Manhattan up to 145th, and we walked down. Mm-hmm. And after we looked at the body, we were walking down 8th Avenue. I'll never forget, he walked to a fish window where there was a fish store with fish lying in the window. And he looked and he said, look at that. And I looked in the window, and all I saw was this fish lying there. It didn't mean anything to me. Then I said, yeah, and he said, but look at all the beautiful colors. And suddenly, just as though he had pushed a button, where the sun was shining on the fins of the fish, I saw all of these purples and yellows and blues that I didn't see before, you know, and things like that. I can't explain to you anymore, but he wasn't a hippy-dippy jazz musician type.
What Charlie Parker did was take a song like How High at the Moon. Da da dee dee dee, da 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 dee, da 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 dee, da 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 dee. So instead of that, he wrote da 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 dee da dee da 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 da.
Did he do that just because it was musically challenging, or was there composer's rights involved?
Charlie Parker was like all geniuses, man, that come to this earth and bring something, and there's no reason for it. It just happens because they have it. It's like Einstein. He was like backward in school, didn't know math, and sat in the back of the room. Nobody thought he was anything. He's the one that, you know, gave us something. He was MC2 and all of that stuff. I just don't know, why did he do that, you know? Charlie Parker was a genius, man.
But I understood that ASCAP would give royalties for the melody, not the chord changes, and that a lot of musicians wrote a new melody line so they can get the royalties from ASCAP.
Well, maybe that was the reason. I don't know. But I'll tell you something. Byrd took two forms of music. I got rhythm and the blues, and he wrote so many different things on top of that. I got rhythm, da da da, you know, a thousand, beep ba doo boop da da da, on the same chords, you know, over and over and over.
And of course, the blues came out of the church.
Well, they say people don't know where the blues came from. I think they came from field hollers, and from the feeling of black people, man. The sorrow songs. You know, when you hear those songs, like the sorrow songs from slavery, like Mary Had 13 Chains, and those old sorrow songs. When you hear them. You can hear, and field hollers, you know, that the slaves used to do. When, like, if you were working in the lower 40 and I was over here cutting wood and you wanted to let me know where you were that day, you would make a cry. Oh, you know, and I'd say, oh, Gilbert's over there today, you know?
Yeah.
Field holler.
Mm-hmm.
Or they would field holler to their girlfriend who may be working in the kitchen. Oh, Marie. I love you so, you know, something like that. And I mean, they weren't able to court and do those things.
I heard also that the music had some politics to it. Is it true that Byrd wrote Now's the Time, called it Now's the Time because of the politics that was generating at that time?
I think so, man. And you know, the story of when Charlie Parker was with Billy Eckstein's band, they pulled up with the bus in front of a club that they were playing in some town. I don't know if it was St. Louis or Kansas City or somewhere like that. And Billy Eckstein was driving in another car. And when the bus pulled up in front of the club and the band started to disembark, the guy outside said, hey, y'all got to go around and come through the kitchen, you know? And Byrd said, we don't have anything to do with the kitchen. We're musicians. We're going on. We come here to play the music. We're in Billy Eckstein's band. He said, I don't care what band you're with. You go through the musicians go through the kitchen. And Byrd said, well, we're not going through the kitchen. We're going through the front door. And that's the story. Mm. But I think Billy Eckstein got messed up because of that. Either he lost the job or was fined or something like that happened.
You know, many people don't know this about B.
They think of him just as a real handsome cat who sang.
Oh, man.
They never know. They don't talk about his orchestra.
Let me tell you something. Billy Eckstein has been totally overlooked. He is really the tree that blossomed that brought bebop on the scene, man. He is the one. Because not only did he sing, he played bebop on that valve trombone. Have you ever heard him play that?
Sure.
And he got those ideas from Dizzy. Dizzy used to teach him, you know, and listening to the band. Dizzy was his musical director.
The trumpet section, at one time or another, the guys that went through there, was Dizzy Gillespie, Fats Navarro, Miles Davis, Gail Brockman, Shorty McConnell, Kenny Dorham, that was a trumpet, Howard McGee. And in the trombones, Benny Green, Jerry Valentine, Chippy Outcall, J.J. Johnson. In the reed section, at one time, this reed section was Charlie Parker playing first, Sonny Stitt playing third, Gene Ammons on one tenor, and Dexter Gordon on the other tenor, and Leo Parker on baritone. The rhythm section was Art Blakey on drums, Tommy Potter on bass, Johnny Malachi playing piano, Connie Wainwright on guitar, and Sarah Vaughan Gill vocals.
In an earlier program, Jackie told me about a very painful chapter in his life.
You know, Gil, you remember quite well that sometime between 1946 and 1950, our great neighborhood that you and I love so much, that Duke Ellington lived in, and Nat Cole and Joe Lewis and Illinois Jacket and Arnett Cobb and all these great musicians lived there. It was a beautiful neighborhood. Suddenly, narcotics arrived in that neighborhood, plentiful. $1 for a cap of heroin, and a lot of my peers began to fall by the wayside.
Our peers, exactly.
Mm-hmm. You know them.
Lucky.
Lucky, all the guys.
Yeah.
And I remember that I was one of the last ones that held out. And finally, one day, I made the mistake of trying to be like one of the guys. And I experimented with some heroin. And it took a chunk of 18 years out of my life. I mean, it destroyed a portion of my life. But I also feel that it was what was meant for me at that particular time. And I lived through it. And I survived, and I'm sitting here today to talk about it. But I would never, ever, if I had the opportunity to go back and change anything, there was only one thing I would change, and I would not have experimented with drugs.
Hated by the musician.
I don't know. It's trivialized. It's like jazz, you know, the same thing. Jazz is trivialized. The way they use it, like, don't hand me that jazz, or you're full of jazz, you know? It's, you know, and of course that came from the word jazz, J-A-S-S, which meant having sex with somebody. You know, and went out and jazzed her, you know.
So modern music was preferred?
Yeah, modern music was the preferred description of what was happening.
Have you had trouble holding on to the tradition of the music that you play and the innovation? You've taken it to another level. You've taken it beyond what Bird was doing in another way. Mm-hmm. Has that been a difficult way to make a living?
Well, you know, the traditional side of the music is always difficult to make a living. If you play that sweet style of soft jazz and acid jazz and all these titles that they give to the very commercial music that's repetitive, you know, I have no problem with a saxophonist like David Sanborn, because David Sanborn at least tries to develop it into the traditional music as well. It just so happens that he's commercially successful and has 1,000 saxophones and millions of dollars. And Kenny G, you know, who never played with any band or with anybody, came out of a circus band. They took him. I mean, everybody knows who Kenny. Here we are in Harlem. You ask anybody who Kenny G is, they know. But you ask them who Charlie Parker is, they don't know.
Yeah.
You know, they don't know anything about anybody. You ask them about John Coltrane, they don't know.
Yeah.
So it's a.
I was asking you about how Bird took the music to another level.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Jackie McLean took it to another level. Describe that. You gave me How High the Moon, Ornithology. Give me an example of where you've taken it.
All right. One day, down this street here at Andy Kirk Jr.'s house, Charlie Parker was up there visiting Mr. Kirk. And I came in there, and I was in there. I was excited because Kirk called me and said, Charlie Parker's here. And, you know, and I dropped my dinner, and my mother, where are you going? I said, I got to go to Kirk's house. I'll be right back. Out the door. I went down, went up there. And I remember as Charlie Parker was leaving, he told me and Kirk, asked us if we ever heard Rites of Spring by Igor Stravinsky. And so I said, no, you know. No, I never heard that. And then he left, you know. So I told Kirk, I said, man, he's trying to throw us off, man. You know, I think he's trying to make us so we won't listen to him so much, or maybe, I don't know what that's about. And I never thought about that again until the day he died. The day Charlie Parker died, I was on a bus, and I opened up a New York Post, and I had just seen Bird that previous Sunday, because we were using the same horn and playing in a club called The Open Door in the Village. And
when you opened the paper?
And I opened up the Post, and I looked in there, and it said, Charlie Parker dead, you know, at the age of so-and-so in the story. And I closed the paper, man, and I remember exactly where I was. I was at about 60th Street in Central Park West on the bus heading uptown. I got off the bus, and I went to a record shop, and I went inside, and I said, have you got this thing called Rites of Spring by Stravinsky somebody? So he said, you talking about Igor Stravinsky? I said, yes. He said, yes, I have it. So I said, well, can I hear it? So he said, no, but you can buy it, you know. It was one of those stores that sold records at that time you couldn't listen to. So he pulled out it had four records in it, 12-inch records on Stravinsky, and I bought it, and I took it home. And when I put that thing on, and I heard that music come over that machine, I was shocked, you know, because this man was way ahead of his time in his world. He had borrowed from a lot of different places. A Rites of Spring, he uses rhythms that come like out of Africa and melodies that come from Mars, and God knows where it came from. And that's what Bird listened to sometime. Bird was very much into Western classical music.
So that kicked Jackie a little
bit. Yeah, it gave me a hell of a kick. And then Harvey Cropper. Remember
bass
Harvey?
Player.
No, painter.
He played bass.
He did
too.
Play bass?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, man.
Yeah.
I just learned something.
Went over to Sweden.
Yeah, that's right. That's Harvey. Harvey played for me Bela Bartok. And I listened to Bartok, and I made a connection between Bartok and Thelonious, because they both had style that was like that. So I began to say, wait a minute now, there's someplace else for this music to go, you know. Even though I had already started dabbling in what they later would call modes, because when I wrote Little Melanie, instead of writing chords for each bar, I wrote like eight bars of one chord, you know, and then eight bars of the same chord, and then the bridge I borrowed from A Night in Tunisia, four bars, and then back to that, for the second four bars, back to that first mode. So it became a long mode with a little intersection in the bridge part, and then back to the mode again. And Miles liked that, so we made a recording of it, you know. So I think I was early
on. What was the name of the recording?
The name of the piece was Little Melanie, and Miles recorded it on Columbia with Train and John and Cannonball and those guys. And he made one, I think he made one with me too, he and I. But
So in a nutshell, you've just taken a different approach to laying out chord structures to a tune.
Yeah, and then I went beyond that to trying to play what I call systems. Things that I play on the saxophone that really don't relate to a song or a chord, but it's close enough for me to have the people that are playing with me relate to it.
Know where you're going.
Yeah, like you heard when you came in the club.
Yeah.
Because that tune that you came in on was called Mr. E, and I wrote it for my drummer, my little drummer. And what makes my band so great is the fact that the guys in my band are mine.
I mean, they're my students. Eric, the drummer, is, I had him since he was 14. Before, yeah. When he was in high school, you know, I told him, you're coming to my college, and he said, yeah, I'm coming.
Your college?
Yeah. But
you haven't talked about that?
Not yet, yeah.
From modest beginnings in Harlem to becoming first a musical prodigy and then a major artist, battling adversity and getting back up, mentoring young musicians, and then on to Hartford University, heading up the music department there, and then even more.
To the University of Hartford, you know, to my department, African American Music Department, which is now the Jackie McLean Institute. So, he came up, and a bunch of young, talented people came up to my program. And I had Jackie Byard teaching there, and that was a big plus for me. Because when he left the school, and he stayed with us for 10 years, when he left the school, I felt as though I lost a leg. You know, it was like a piano with one leg missing.
And you were teaching these kids this music that you had mastered.
Yeah, and I was teaching them in two ways. One, in the history class. I thought that the history was the most important thing for them to hear. And they weren't ready to hear that, Ragtime and Jelly Roll Morton and all that. These guys want to hear John Coltrane. I said, you're not going to hear that this semester. We're going back to Africa. That's where we're going. And we're going to listen to these different drums, and we're going to listen to the music of the African continent. And I'm going to go to Europe. I'm going to make some comparisons between Bach and you know, the music is has nothing to do with anybody's race or anything too much.
But are you telling me then that history is an important part of this music, that you really need to know the history of the world in order to be a complete musician to some degree?
I coined a phrase for my students. I say, you never can. I say, you guys that want to play something new on your horn, you never know what's new until you find out what's old. Then you might find out that what you think is new is really not new. It's really old. And it's just reinterpreted, you know? And so I got them so they loved it. You know, they loved my history courses. The first course went from traditional African music in Egypt. And I mean, it had a lot to your visit to Egypt. I played that tape for them all the time, you know? And the pyramids and all of that. Because they had no idea that there was a world before Greece and Italy and England and those places, you know? That there was a world before BC, you know? What went on before Christ? Nothing.
Jackie McLean's legacy is not just limited to the recordings, but you have something up in Hartford where you now live called the Artist Collective.
Yes. That was a dream, and that too came...
Captained by your better half.
Yeah, by my wife, yeah, she... The idea, though, she raised the money, and she's the one that made the program work. But I started working with kids here in New York when Dolly and I moved to the Lower East Side, because I had a drum and bugle corps, as you remember. I had a drum and bugle corps, and this was something I wanted to do with the kids in my building and in my neighborhood. And so we started a drum and bugle corps. We had that. We marched in parades. We did all of that. And then I went and moved up to and started working at HRUAC. For 1 month I worked there up in Harlem. And so I had already, you know, had an idea that it was important to give back to the community what it was that the community that I come from gave me, you know, this neighborhood, what it gave me. We went into the school building.
I remember that.
Right, and we stayed there for about almost 20 years, and it was during that time that we decided we needed a bigger building. We started a capital campaign, and my wife, through her diligence and her brilliance and everything that she had, she took her 15 years to raise the money, you know, the $8 million to put that building up. And it stands there now. It came up in 1999. President Clinton came to the building, and it's just a wonderful place.
Would you say then to the musician that they ought to try to do something similar? Not just play, but to give back in whatever way you can best do it.
That's right. And all of my students that I have at the university, I tell them, I said, when you reach a certain level, you now will go over to the Artist Collective in the North End community. I know a little kid is white or black, wherever he comes from. I said, I know you're white and you came out from another part of town, but you, come on, man.
No, not this way. The other way.
Come on, man, get out of here.
What you mean? It's
Reminds me of you, Jack.
Yeah, I know. Reminds me of you.
Jackie, thanks, man, for coming all the way down from Hartford. Thanks for being my friend.
Oh, man.
Thanks for being such a magnificent musician.
Oh, man.
You know, thank you.
Right back at you, Gil.
No, man, don't start.
No, I'm serious, man. I'm serious. No, it's time for you to understand what you've given me.
That's another story. The song today is you.
Yeah, but I wouldn't be able to sing it without you.
My good buddy. Yeah.
On what you've seen. Let us know what you